Welcome back, everybody, to the Friday night Bible study. Sabbath Bible study, right? Our days are getting longer here in Colorado. And I'll tell you what, I like a longer day. When it's dark at like 4 o'clock, it's just, you know, by the time we do Bible study, you've been up 3 hours past dark. That just doesn't seem right, does it? It's good to see everybody on Zoom. We still have some people logging on. Welcome. Good to see you. We're glad you're joining us again. We're still studying Daniel chapter 11 while we can freely do so, right? Do it while we can. You know, when we talk, when we study the Bible and Jesus says, you know, that he's coming like a thief, you know, that, you know, if we're saying what's the delay or we're acting like we fall asleep, maybe I should say, we're doing that with Bible study too, don't you think? You know, we talk about being ready for probation and then being ready, obviously, for the second coming, Jesus. But I mean, we've got to take advantage of being able to study together in fellowship, because when that's taken away, that's going to be tough, isn't it? You know, so I'm really happy to see everybody. That's what I'm getting at there. I don't want to sound all gloomy, but it's so nice to see all the different faces, you know, and I wish I could see the faces of everybody on YouTube. Our subscribers are climbing up. We're almost at 400, and so we just want to thank you for tuning in again from wherever you're watching. We're glad that you're studying with us, and please continue to do so. Continue to do the things that you do with YouTube. Hey, we like a video, we share the video, you know, so let's keep doing that while we can. Seven more subscribers to get to 400. Should be easy. Everybody, this group here on Zoom can just send out a little text to somebody and say, hey, sign up. We're trying to get the 400. Plus we got the most amazing Bible studies. I don't know about most amazing, but we do study. You got to study for yourself. You got to test everybody, right? Test me. Don't believe it because I'm saying it, because we're reading it from the syllabus. Believe it because you're studying scripture for yourself with the guidance of the Holy Spirit. So with that, let's go ahead and pray and we'll start our Bible study. Real quick though, my computer wants to do a restart. Let's do no. Okay, now we can bow our heads. Heavenly Father, just want to thank you that we can still freely gather together in fellowship and study your word. We need the guidance of the Holy Spirit to understand the words that we're studying so that our lives can be changed, that our hearts would grow in compassion and be filled with the love that your son has for us that comes from you. We're so grateful that you're our God. We choose you this day. Thank you so much for the Sabbath and for making this day holy. Please help us to understand that better, to keep it in a manner that's pleasing to you, and to be able to do good on the Sabbath. We ask for a spiritual refreshment and protection from evil. And from temptation, we need the strength to overcome. You've given us the victory. Help us to claim it. We're so grateful that you're our God. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, we're on page 115 in your syllabus. 115, middle of the page. We're going to pick up where we left off from our last study. So it's actually not easy to do a recap. Some of you know it, that the little inside joke on that, because I used to always have to do recaps because we had different people attend Bible study every week. It'd be a whole different group. And then I'm like, they're not going to know where we're studying. Then we do a recap. Well, two reasons we don't have to do a recap. One, because they're all recorded and you can just rewatch the videos. Two, I've been encouraged not to do recaps as much, which helps me get through the syllabus. So thank you, Bible study students. And three, man, we're studying this in Revelation. We're studying this constantly. You should start to remember things, I hope. I hope the dots are connecting as you continue the studies. We're talking about the King of the South. And we went over some quotes last week, and I don't normally like stopping in the middle of kind of a specific chapter, but again, on the videos, you can end last week, start this one, like no time at all had taken place. But we're going to start where it says two critical questions that confront us at this point. One, did the Roman Catholic papacy overcome aesthetic communism through great military and economic power? And two is the papacy in the process of recovering its awesome global power. What would make the papacy have awesome global power? What does papacy represent? What does papacy mean? Yes, I see somebody, right? The joining together, or it is the union, I should say, of church and state, right? So you can, you know, when there's political pressure, government pressure, civil pressure, people can kind of get their way, can't they? Even if you don't agree with them. And you've all been around the last couple of years and know what I'm talking about. Okay, so this is, you know, we get a little taste, a little understanding, a template of what that union really does. Someone might object that the papacy hasn't fired a single missile at aesthetic communism. However, how can anyone say with a straight face that the papacy overcame aesthetic communism with great military and economic strength? Well, the answer is quite simple. Papacy does not need its own military. Do you hear that? Papacy doesn't need its own military. Doesn't need its own economic strength. The papacy's history has been one of piggybacking on the nations that already have military and economic strength. Papacy then uses their resources or forces to accomplish its purposes. Has the papacy done this in recent years? Well, let's see how this is a big resounding yes. Before the fall of the Iron Curtain, 1989, hey, we were talking about this, a few of us tonight. So the fall of the Iron Curtain, 1989, the late Malachi Martin boldly predicted in his book, The Keys of This Blood, maybe some of you have it, I've got it on my bookshelf, it's a good resource, that the papacy would eventually conquer its two global competitors, which is Marxism and Western capitalism. Shortly after the publication of Martin's book, the Iron Curtain came tumbling down. Though this was a remarkable event in itself, even more remarkable was the manner in which the Iron Curtain came down. Notice this, the cover of Time magazine, February 24, 1992, bears the title Holy Alliance. And portrayed on the cover are Ronald Reagan and Pope John Paul II. The subtitle tells it all. It says, how Reagan and the Pope conspired to assist Poland's solidarity movement and hasten the demise of communism. This fascinating article, cover article written by Carl Bernstein, 1992, explains how the Vatican and the United States, two philosophical enemies, to be sure, did what? Joined forces to precipitate the fall of the Iron Curtain. The United States took advantage of the vast intelligence network provided by the Vatican, while the United States in turn contributed its vast technological, economical, and military resources. So notice this quote here. At their first meeting, Reagan and John Paul II discussed something else they had in common. Both had survived assassination attempts only 6 weeks apart in 1981, and both believed God had saved them for a special mission. According to National Security Advisor Clark, the Pope and Reagan referred to the miraculous fact that they had survived. Clark said that the men shared a unity of spiritual view and a unity of vision on the Soviet Empire. That right or correctness would ultimately prevail in the divine plan. Interesting, yeah? And I don't know if some of you attended prophecy seminars, you know, or Daniel Revelation seminars, evangelistic meetings, and remember studying that, you know, that was one of the kind of signs of the times then, you know, in the mid-90s, you know, this is something that would get brought up quite a bit. So much has happened since then, you know, you just kind of keep adding to the list of how prophecy is being fulfilled. Bernstein painstakingly documented and amplified the details of this Holy Alliance in his book called His Holiness that he co-authored with Marco Politi. This book is required reading for anyone who wishes to truly understand the deep entanglement of the United States with the Vatican in the overthrow of Soviet communism. Now, the secular media has recognized that the U.S., particularly during the presidency of Ronald Reagan, used its enormous economic resources to build up and modernize its military. The country incurred huge deficits in the process, and the result was that the Soviet Union could no longer compete. The Soviet Union could no longer expend huge chunks of its national budget on defense and still feed its citizens. When the Iron Curtain fell, all could see that the Soviet Union was virtually bankrupt. It was an economic necessity, not a philosophical change from Marxism to capitalism, that prompted Mikhail Gorbachev to cry out something in Russia, in Russian. You can see it in your syllabus. If somebody, what is it? Perestroika, glasnost. And I'm sorry, people who speak Russian, for butchering that. All right, let's notice what Fred Barnes writes. Look, we're studying the King of the South and its characteristics according to Daniel chapter 11. So if this is the first time you're studying with us and it just sounds like a history lesson, we would really encourage you to start with study number one and catch up with us so you can have more context on why we're studying what we're studying here. Now, Fred Barnes wrote about the economic and military role of Ronald Reagan's presidency in the demise of Soviet communism. Let's have somebody on Zoom read this on page 117. This is in the middle of the page, Bert, and where it says in 1921, and it looks like you got a couple paragraphs, and this is from Reader's Digest, Fred Barnes' article on Communism's Incredible Collapse, March 1990, page 105.
In 1981, the communist bloc got another shock. A new American president, Ronald Reagan, began fulfilling his promise to challenge the Soviets, not placate them. Over the next few years, he accelerated the military buildup and announced the Strategic Defense Initiative, a space-based system for protecting against the missile attack. He backed anti-communist rebels in Nicaragua, Angola, Cambodia, Afghanistan, and with the American troops, he liberated the island of Grenada from communist thugs. The Soviet confidence was shaken. Western Europeans also pressured the Soviets. NATO forged ahead with military modernization. German voters spurned Soviet peace overtures and elected a government that voted to deploy new intermediate range missiles. Military pressures from America and its Western allies had caused the Soviets to flinch.
And again, that's from Fred Barnes, the article he wrote, Communism's Incredible Collapse. Continuing on with that, let's have another volunteer. There's another shorter paragraph. Terry, go ahead with that again. March 1990, page 105 of Reader's Digest, Fred Barnes writes,
in the 1980s, communist economies, always inefficient, went belly up. Before, they lacked consumer and luxury goods. Now, perennial shortages of staples worsened as well. When Soviet miners went on strike in 1989, their demands included soap, toilet paper, and sugar. Reader's Digest, March 1990.
An article in the U.S. News and World Report agrees. This is, again, this is the year 1990, January 15. U.S. News and World, and the article is titled Collapse of Communism in the Soviet Union Next? Let's have another volunteer that has the syllabus. Hoku, if you'll go ahead and read that, please.
As the economy of the Soviet Union deteriorates and shortages grow, public disillusionment with communism and with Gorbachev himself is rising, and hostile republics, nationalities, and interest groups are competing more fiercely for political power and for shares in the shrinking economy. Corruption and crime are rampant. Miners and railway workers threaten to cut off fuel supplies during the bitter winter. Azerbaijanis cut the rain line to Armenian enclave and their midst. Farmers hoard food, leaving city shelves bare.
As you read this, you know, and this is something that the article's talking about in the event that took place in 1989. Are there some similarities? Like, do you hear just from some of these articles, like similarities that maybe we're starting to see now? You know what? Remember, when we study history, we're looking for the signs that point to you know, things that we're going through today as a means to give us an education and a lesson on how to be prepared and really what's in store, right? The biblical perspective is for us to encourage each other. And we do that by sharing the hope that is in Christ, right? That good, by showing that good triumphs over evil, right? It has. With that being said, also, it's, you know, we sometimes still mesh or, you know, mold together these lessons of hope in that the world's going to be better. Do you know what I mean? And the world's not going to be better, right? I mean, if we're teaching from the Bible, the world gets worse and worse and so much worse, right? But the message that comes from out of our mouths, right, that comes from the throne of God, that comes through his word, the guidance of the Holy Spirit, is a message of hope that just gets better and better and better for us. So do you see, but you know, that we sing a song when we kneel down to pray at church, turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things on earth do what? Grow strangely dim, right? In the light of his glory and grace. Like, that's the message, right? So when we're looking up to God, you know, like, we see, you know, we have the hope, we see that where the light comes from, and we see the path clearly while the things on earth grow dim, you know. And so we've been singing the song for a long time, you know, and we share it. So we want to let people know, like, look, the world's not going to get better. These conditions aren't going to get better. Maybe, I don't know, maybe for some of you who contemplate this a lot or think about it a lot, maybe there'll be a time of respite where it'll catch people off guard, right? Oh, it seems like maybe that time's happening. I don't know. You know, how many people said after, you know, or during the pandemic, I can't wait for things to go back to normal. That's not a very biblical perspective, is it? But I get the human perspective. You know, we want things to be good, and that is a genuine, what's normal? In the chat window, what's normal, right? Not what we were going through. You know, anytime anything weird happens, we're like, oh, I just want things to go back to normal. But we don't know what normal is. We know biblically that the world, and that, look, it says the heart, the love of many will wax cold, Matthew 24, because of what? Because of lawlessness. I think some translations say because of a transgression of the law, you know, iniquity, you know, these expressions. It's like the love of many will grow cold. You know, do we believe that? You know, so it's interesting as we read. And if you have a thought or a comment you want to share in it, please just raise your hand or type it in the chat. But as we read something that, I mean, for me, this has happened in my lifetime, you know, talking about it, you know, I was, mom and I were just talking tonight. I was born in Germany. You know, the wall was still up when we lived in Germany. The Berlin Wall was still there, you know. So it's, we were talking historical events to see who could make themselves sound the oldest. So my mom won. She normally does win on that one. So I see you shaking your head, Eileen. I see you. That's all right. Hey, anybody who knows my mom and I know that we give each other a hard time, but I won't say anything, Mom. Don't worry. I'll wait till we're not recording, you know, but I got a good one. I got a good one for that. So, but you know, it's interesting as when we look back, especially like with Daniel chapter 7, and we study, you know, the characteristics of the little horn during the dark ages. Do you think it's easy to separate ourselves from that because we weren't alive during when that happened? There's kind of a lot of that, don't you think? You're like, oh, when you look at, you know, you look at church and state that crucified Jesus, right? Jesus was falsely accused by the church, nailed to the cross by the state. Church and state, right? You know, we talk about it and we study it and we should, you know, and I wonder though, like how serious do we take it? And then you see the 1260 years of papal persecution. And, you know, we talk about it, we study about it, we have a lot of records, and it's just like, oh, it's going to happen again. Oh yeah, it's going to happen again. And then when one thing happens, i.e. what's happened in the last couple of years, we're all begging for normalcy. You know, and it's just like, you know, we kind of soon forget, you know, when we read the history here, you know, the Iron Curtain was kind of a big deal, wasn't it? The Cold War? No, no, there's people on that, you know, that was a daily thing to be concerned about, you know. In this country, I study history a lot. You know, my family was in the military, and you know, it was a big deal. But you know, it's been 30 years since the wall fell, 34 years. So it's kind of out of sight, out of mind, isn't it? We kind of forget history, don't we? And the turmoil that Eastern Europe finally led Gorbachev to seek a personal audience with Pope John Paul. Significantly, it wasn't John Paul II who was visiting Gorbachev, but rather the leader of the Soviet bloc who was traveling to visit the Pope. Notice this article in Time magazine. This is written December 4, 1989. Let's have somebody read this. This is on page 118 in your syllabus. It's the last paragraph. Okay, Bert, go ahead.
Of all the events that have shaken the Soviet bloc in 1989, none is more fraught with history or more implausible than the polite encounter to take place this week in Vatican City. There is a spacious ceremonial library in the 16th century apostolic palace that the czar of the world atheism, Mikhail Gorbachev, will visit the vicar of Christ, Pope John Paul II. The moment will be electric, not only because John Paul helped inflame the fever of freedom in his Polish homeland that swept like brush fire across the Eastern Europe. Beyond that, the meeting of the two men symbolized the end of the 20th century's most dramatic spiritual war, a conflict in which seemingly irresistible forces of communism battered against the immovable object of Christianity.
This is recent history, folks. You know, this is, I mean, these names are familiar, aren't they? Pope John Paul II and Mikhail Gorbachev. Let's continue reading a little bit more on this. Time magazine, this is 1989, December 11, uses significant historical analogy to describe the historic encounter between Gorbachev and John Paul II. Notice this, it says in Oku, we were looking at this in pictures of the Fox Book of Martyrs, you know, when the Holy Roman Emperor Henry IV decided to seek pardon of Pope Gregory VII in 1077. He stood barefoot for 3 days in the snow outside the papal quarters in Canossa, Italy. Gorbachev's concordat with the church was no less significant in this way. Now, have you guys studied that in Reformation history? You've got pictures of it in the illustrated Fox Book of Martyrs that has the illustrations, and you see the king, Henry IV, standing out there. And the Pope made him wait 3 days in the snow. And here you have that historical event being compared to Gorbachev meeting Pope John Paul II. Isn't that amazing? How many people do you think then were saying, nothing new under the sun? Ecclesiastes 1:9, nothing new under the sun. That this secular magazine would compare John Paul II with Gregory VII and Gorbachev with Henry IV is amazing. What the author is saying is that John Paul II humbled Gorbachev in 1989, much as his predecessors, had done in Canossa with Henry IV in 1077. An article in Newsweek, these are secular records, right? So it's neat to have these resources. Another reason to get a syllabus that you can download. I forgot to remind people on YouTube that you can go on our description link and download this syllabus for free and then purchase it after the Sabbath if you want. But these are great. So if you have like a highlighter that you guys do, you know, different topics with different colors, make sure you light up these pages, you know, with a secular record, you know, so because when we read from this, some people think that, oh, this is what Pastor Boers wrote, you know, or when we read books, you know, it sounds like, oh, maybe it's just coming from one person. But you want these articles, put a little post-it note, right, Savannah, a little post-it note sticker tab thing, you know, where you can easily flip to and like, look, this happened in history. You know, this is written. These are secular magazines and articles that are being written here. In Newsweek, December 25, 1989, describe the timeline events that led to the fall of communism. Led to the fall of what? What is this? What? So why are we talking about communism at this point? Because we're getting characteristics of who in Daniel chapter 11. King of the South. That's right. I saw somebody else say it. Good job. King of the South. We're getting those characteristics. How important are the characteristics? Now, this may seem boring, right? We're like, here we go. Another article. What are they talking about? It's not blah, blah, right? I'm having a little like reminiscence, Paul, a little nostalgia from our Daniel 7 study, you know, where we went over article, we went over book, record, and stuff that spanned 1,000 years. You know, and you'd think it was the same person writing the exact same thing, but they're different people in different parts of the world talking about the same power. And we're seeing that take place here. And I see in some of your comments real quick on the chat, Terry's talking, we were talking about turn your eyes upon Jesus. There's a worship song asking God to turn this world. Oh, you're saying there's a worship song asking God to turn this world around. Look, we want God to turn this world around, right? He's going to turn it around inside out, split it apart, and destroy it. Read the seventh plague. Read Jeremiah. And then when he comes back after the millennium, it's gonna be purified, isn't it? It's going to be cleansed. And then what does John say in Revelation? And I saw a new heaven. That's a beautiful song, Mom. We need to have someone sing that at church. And I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth did what? They passed away. Look, keep recycling, do your part, you know, but ultimately the first world, which would be the world we're in now, does what? Biblically, what does the Bible say? It passes away. And if you want detail on that, you got to study with us, Daniel and Revelation, because we go into some serious detail. The last anchor class went through some serious detail on the condition of the earth. God creates a new heavens and a new earth. We don't have to fix this earth, do we? We need our heart fixed. That's what needs to be fixed. We need our hearts fixed. This earth will pass away. And then God creates a new heaven and a new earth. That's a better plan than anybody has on this world. There is no better plan. And by the way, that's God's plan. So it's going to happen. It's going to happen whether you like it or not. One of my favorite quotes, David Asherick said this. I'm going to name drop him because it was at ASI in Albuquerque 20 years ago. But he made this comment. He says, God is who he is, whether you like it or not. But the more you get to know God, the more you like it. You know, music to your ears, right? Okay. Let me go back to this. There's a reason we're studying these characteristics. Because you're going to have people that are going to want to debate you. There's going to be people who want to study with you. There's going to be people who may approach you with another perception of the little horn or the king of the north or the king of the south. And you want to be able to show them biblically and then historically the characteristics of that king of the south or the king of the north or whoever it is you're discussing. Because they're not going to have this content. They're not going to be able to use any of this content. It'll be a skin deep, sensationalist perspective, you know, to try to get you to believe, oh, the King of the South has nothing to do with atheism or communism, you know, has nothing to do with the French Revolution. It's talking about, I don't know, they're going to name some country in the world right now that's doing something stupid, which in reality, they're kind of all doing something stupid now, you know. Significantly, the title of the article in Newsweek, this is the December 25th issue, 1989, was called Whirlwind. Is the very one that appears in that very word that appears in Daniel chapter 11 that we read last week. Remember reading that in verse 41? when we get the description of the King of the North's counterattack on who? The King of the South. Who's the King of the North? Papal Rome. Give me another one. Who can type fast? I'll give you a couple seconds in between each of my reminders of who the King of the North is. Papal Rome. And also, no fast typers. Well, some of you are on your phone, so that's hard. Some of you aren't even trying. Come on now. Some of you are trying. Papacy. Yep, I got that one already. Harlot. All right, got it. Good job. Anybody else? Is that somebody else's too? Anybody else? We go over this every week. Son of perdition. Nice. Got it. What someone's pointing up? King of the North. Who else? Right? The harlot. Perdition. Daniel chapter 7. What's the focal point in Daniel chapter 7? Yeah, Antichrist. The little horn. That's right. The little horn, right? It's the same power. So the little horn being Papal Rome, we know it's Papal Rome. We've gone over the history for the last 2 years of it. And we're not talking about members of the Catholic Church. You know, some of you remind you of that because God has people in every church. But it's undeniably the system of church and state that is Papal Rome. And was there an attack against Papal Rome? Was Papal Rome given a deadly wound? Was the beast, that's another one, huh? The beast that comes up out of the sea, Revelation 13, having 7 heads and 10 horns? Yeah, it's called the French Revolution. How'd that work out for Christians and Catholics? It was awful. Massacre. I was looking for books today, old books again, and I came across a couple of volumes that were just about the French Revolution. So I put it on. I put a little, when you favorite it, when you heart something, I'll have to do a little more research on the person who wrote the book. But there's a 2-volume set on just the French Revolution alone. You know, and those of you who have your great controversies, there is a chapter on the French Revolution. I really want you guys to read it because I want you to tell me things that you recognize from that historical time that are similar now. We've been going through it in our 7 trumpet study. So if you want to know a little bit more about it, I think actually we finished the French Revolution, didn't we, Paul? We actually finished a chapter. We're still studying the 5th trumpet, but I think we're moving on from, I think we spent 6 weeks studying the French Revolution in part of all of those studies. So there's just the similarities are exhausting. Yeah, they're parallel. That's right, Terry. I see it. They're hand in hand, exactly alike. Notice the description of King of the North. So the King of the South attacks the King of the North. We saw that French Revolution, saw what the motive behind the French Revolution was. Other examples biblically of the King of the South, right? Because the King of the South represents atheism and communism, but we also see the King of the North as Sodom, right? So we want to study those characteristics of those nations or those economic powers, if you will, at that time. And you're going to see the scary similarities to the way the world is today. But the notice verse 41. We're in our Bibles, Daniel chapter 11. Let's read verse 41. Let's have somebody that feels sleepy go ahead and read Daniel chapter 11, verse 41 on Zoom. I know all that. I trust me, I get it. Hearing stuff read to you, it's exhausting on articles. And I mean that from my heart. So Doug, are you admitting that you were sleepy? Or are you just being cool and down to read?
Yes, sir.
Exactly. Right. Daniel 11, 41, please, sir.
He shall also enter the glorious land, and many countries shall be overthrown, but these shall escape from his hand. Edom, Moab, and the prominent people of Ammon.
Now, we're going to get to the rest of that verse, but in particular, it says that who's he talking about? He, the King of the North now, right? Because he's just survived an attack from the King of the South. We've read historically how the King of the North has defeated in the process of as a whirlwind against the King of the South, right? Are you with me? When you write in your syllabus, I know we underline things, but if you've got to write on a page or a separate page, like King of the South, and then you put the characteristics, you write it down so you have it, right? Communism, atheism, Pharaoh, Egypt, Sodom, French Revolution, Age of Enlightenment, evolution, right? These are all King of the South characteristics. And then you have your King of the North characteristic, right? The little horn in Daniel chapter 7, and it has the eyes like a man of the mouth speaking pompous words and blasphemies, and it sits itself as though he's God and he tramples the saints of the Most High, right? All of these characteristics. So if you do that, so you have it kind of condensed on a piece of paper for you, it'll help you remember those, right? It actually helps me remember to say it, to read it, to write it, you know, down. So then all these characteristics are in my head all the time. So when we go through this, we understand this. Now the King of the North, so he's overwhelmed the King of the South. Remember, he did that through military and through ships. We talked about how that represents the economical and the merchants and trade. And he overwhelmed them, passed through. And as Doug just read, he shall also enter the glorious land. Well, let's talk about this. If you have the NIV, it says he will invade the glorious land. Literally speaking, the glorious land, which is the same expression seen in verse 16, represents the geographical territory of what? Of Israel. The identical word is translated pleasant land in Daniel chapter 8 and verse 9. Study we've done. You can look up. Goodly heritage is the expression used in Jeremiah 3:19. And the glory of all lands in Ezekiel 26 and 20, in Ezekiel chapter 20, verses 6 and 15. This is cool to, again, highlight this because you're getting the different expressions for the geographical territory of Israel. So we have the glorious land, the pleasant land, goodly heritage, and the glory of all lands. Are those talking about different places on the earth? We used to have a place. Hey, who's been in Colorado long enough? Remember Heritage Square? Who remembers that? Yeah. See, that's another way. I'm just trying to make everybody look older. Oh, even some people turn their cameras on. I saw it. That's good. I was there too. Okay. Pretty much everybody in Colorado knows. It wasn't that long ago. It closed down. Is this talking about goodly heritage? Talking about Heritage Square? Where you sit on a little mat and slide down a slide. Remember that big old slide down there? No, this is talking about the same thing. We're getting that glorious land, pleasant land, goodly heritage, glory of all lands, talking about the territory of Israel. So what does the glorious land represent in the end time? Because is it pointing us now? Is it trying to point us back to the Middle East so that we focus on the Middle East to see what's going to happen? No. No, we need another children's song. All the children's songs that we learned, Doug, since we should have you write one, you know, and write one about not looking over to the Middle East, you know, for prophetic fulfillment in the end times. I think it's time to add some new children's songs here. You got a son that plays the guitar real well, and a daughter-in-law that sings beautifully. I think you guys should do a children's song. So I'm nominating you officially, and mom plays the piano. You can help them out. All right. And Terry, looks like you were saying you'd love to help them out. So I'll volunteer you as well. We're not trying to look toward the Middle East. Come on, guys. Let's go to John chapter 4, verses 20 through 24. Let's have somebody, actually, Terry, you were the last one to raise your hand. Would you please read John chapter 4, verses 20 through 24. Let's open up our Bibles.
Okay. Our fathers worshipped on this mountain, and you Jews say that in Jerusalem is the place where one ought to worship. Jesus said to her, "Woman, believe me, the hour is coming when you will neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem worship the Father. You worship what you do not know. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. But the hour is coming, and now is, when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father is seeking such to worship him. The next one?
Yes, 24.
God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and in truth.
Oh man, we could have a whole
I love that. It's like goosebump.
Go ahead, Terry.
It's just like goosebumps when you think about it.
Goosebumps indeed, the good goosebumps, right? That God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship him in spirit and truth. Look, that's a cool factoid, Bible fact. How do you worship God? You know how, have you ever said or heard somebody say, I worship in my own way? You know, we're told how to worship. Praise God, we're told how to worship. You know, and here's a good text for that we worship him in spirit of truth. He's talking to the Samaritan woman, by the way, in this little bit of context. And he told her that after Pentecost, there would be no more literal and local holy lands or holy mountains. Therefore, we must ask, what does the glorious land represent? However, before we're able to answer this question, we got to determine why God chose literal Israel and why he planted them in the literal glorious land. And here's the main points. We're on page 120 in your syllabus. We're about to start where all the little check marks are, okay? We're answering some questions of why God chose literal Israel and why he planted them in the literal glorious land. Checkpoint number one, Israel spent 430 years captive in Egypt. And at the end of that period, check number two, God delivered them from bondage and took them where? To the glorious land. Checkpoint three, in the glorious land, they had the freedom to worship the true God according to the dictates of their conscience. Could they worship that way in Egypt? Do you remember when Moses was trying to convince Pharaoh to let God's people go? And he wanted to honor the Sabbath, right? Let us go and honor the Sabbath. They wouldn't let him do it. Could they worship according to the dictates of their conscience? Well, in the glorious land, they could. Checkpoint number four. The land of Canaan flowed with milk and honey, which is the glory of all lands. That's in Ezekiel chapter 20, verses 6 and 15. Which is a euphemism for unparalleled abundance and prosperity. God gave Israel every possible material advantage to become the greatest nation on earth. Does that sound familiar, anybody? Type it in the chat. Tell me you're with me on this. Why does that sound familiar? The U.S., right? E.G. Dub says, did we read that last week? Some of these studies kind of seem like one, Paul, when we're talking about this, but said that this land has been blessed more than any nation ever in the history of the world. This country has. Next bullet point number, or checkpoint number five, Israel was to guard the law. Was to do what? Was to guard the law. If you love me, Jesus says, what do? You keep my commandment. And the word keep is to guard, right? To safeguard. You will guard or you obey my commandments. Israel was to guard the law and to preserve the worship of the true God. Next checkpoint. The land of Israel was at the very hub of three continents, Europe, Asia, and Africa. God had a providential purpose in placing Israel in this strategic location. As people from all three continents came through Israel, God's people would have the excellent opportunity of giving witness to the true God. Notice this purpose clearly enunciated in Isaiah 49, verse 6. Let's have somebody on Zoom. Isaiah chapter 49 and verse 6, if you would read that. Okay, Paul.
It says, and he said, it is a light thing that thou shouldest be my servant to raise up the tribes of Jacob and to restore the preserved of Israel. I will also give thee for a light to the Gentiles, that thou mayest be my salvation unto the end of the earth.
Yeah, isn't that amazing too? I will also give thee for a light to who? To the Gentiles. last check mark here, it says God warned Israel that if they should prove unfaithful to him, they would lose their prosperity and ultimately the land itself. So to speak, national apostasy would lead to national ruin. In effect, this is precisely what happened. Notice this, what Ellen White describes. I think this is going to be great. This is Prophets and Kings. It says God's law must be exalted. And this is Prophets and Kings, page 16 and 17. His authority maintained. And the house of Israel was given this great and noble work. What was Israel's great and noble work? For God's law to be, to exalt God's law and to maintain his authority. God separated them from the world that he might commit them to a sacred trust. By the way, if you're wondering, what is my purpose on earth? We're reading it right now. Okay. What is God's purpose for me? We're literally reading it right now. So if you have the color of pen, this is the color that means something personal to me that I take personal. This is when you want to circle this. Okay. God separated them, Israel, from the world that he might commit them to a sacred trust. He made them the depositaries of his law. He purposed through them to preserve among men the knowledge of himself. Thus, the light of heaven was to shine out. Check that out. The result of exalting God's law, maintaining his authority, in cooperation with God to preserve the knowledge of who God is, the light of heaven shined out through them and will shine out through you. That's a promise from God. The light shines out through you to a world enshrouded in darkness, and a voice was to be heard appealing to all peoples to turn away from idolatry, to serve the living God. Why turn away from idolatry? Why serve the living God? Because he is God. There is none like him. With great power, continuing on in a mighty hand, quoting Exodus 32:11, God brought his chosen people out of the land of Egypt. He sent Moses, his servant, and Aaron, whom he had chosen. They showed his signs among them and wonders in the land of Ham. He rebuked the Red Sea also, and it was dried up. So he led them through the depths. Psalms 105, just quoting Psalm 105, verses 26, 27, and Psalm 106, verse 9. He rescued them from their servile state, that he might bring them to a good land, a land which in his providence he had prepared for them as a refuge from their enemies. He would bring them to himself and encircle them in his everlasting arms. And in return for his goodness and mercy, they were to exalt his name and make it glorious in the earth. Is the world exalting the law of God today? Do we see that? Is the knowledge of who God really is being relayed and given to the people of the world? What's the condition of that? Is God's authority being maintained? That God is in control? And look at the chaos in the world today. If we would teach that he would bring them to himself and encircle them with his everlasting arms in return for his goodness and mercy, we exalt his name and make it glorious in the earth. The Lord's portion in is his people. Jacob is the lot of his inheritance. He found him in a desert land and in the waste howling wilderness. He led him about. He instructed him. He kept him as the apple of his eye. As an eagle stirreth up her nest, fluttereth over her young, spreadeth abroad her wings, taketh them, beareth them on her wings. So the Lord alone did lead him, and there was no strange God with him. Deuteronomy 32, verses 9 through 12. Thus, he brought the Israelites unto himself that they might dwell under the shadow of the Most High. Miraculously preserved from the perils of the wilderness wandering, they were finally established in the land of promise as what kind of nation? As a favored nation. When you study this in the Bible, did other nations know about it? Oh, you know they did. Oh, they heard. Oh, the news of what God does doesn't stay hidden. It went worldwide. It was, so much more could have been accomplished, obviously. We know that had God's people remained faithful to him, because their enemies feared them. You know, there's so many examples, you know, of that. The enemies fearing Israel. They were a favored nation. It is impossible to miss the striking similarities between the providential establishment, we're on page 122, of ancient Israel and the glorious land and God's plan for the Protestant pilgrims who fled to the United States from papal persecution in Europe. Want to see the similarities? Well, if you have a syllabus, they're in there. Another list of checkpoints. Let's go through these. Bottom page 122. God's people were in bondage to the Roman Catholic papacy for 1260 years. That's the Dark Ages. We've been studying that for a long time now. Toward the end of this period, God's people fled from Europe to the earth. And that's the territory that would become the United States. Revelation 13, remember the beast, the second beast that comes up out of the earth. First one comes up out of the sea. Second one comes up out of the earth, which helped them, Revelation 12, 16. In this new land, they sought freedom to do what? To worship God according to the dictates of their own conscience. Then our First Amendment. This land was truly a good land. Top of page 123. This land was truly a good land with almost unlimited material resources conducive to the proclamation. For what purpose? The proclamation of the gospel to the world. Let's never forget that. Everything that God provides, he provides for us the means to be able to share the gospel to the world. That is our goal. How do we do that? We exalt the law, right? We maintain his authority. We speak of his name and share the knowledge of who God really is. I know talking with some of you, you know, he's got a bad rap. And people aren't reading their Bibles, though. They're not studying their Bibles. So they have this idea of how God is, right? And I think, Paul, you and I were talking about it. I think it was you, you know, like, or Hoku. Maybe it's Hoku says, what kind of God? Maybe you've all had that comment told you. What kind of God would? And then kind of fill in the blank, right? What kind of God would burn people, you know, eternally? And you know what we say? That's such a good question. That's not the God we serve. And the God in the Bible isn't that God. That's an opportunity to share the truth. People have a very warped perception because the knowledge of who he really is isn't being shared to the world like it should be. Now, there are people that are doing it. There's ministries that are doing it. Question is, are you going to do it? All right, next checkpoint. God proposed. Now, let me read a couple of your comments. It says, God uses the willing. We have the three angels, Revelation 14, absolutely. Another comment, we bear the testimony of Jesus. That's something, and that's a good thing, right? We have another comment that says, God equips the unequipped. You can read that in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 16 and 17. It's all scripture's inspiration, am I right? That's the text you're quoting there. And it's profitable, right? It's got good things for you for doctrine, for correction, instruction, and righteousness. I mean, it's a teachable thing. We got a couple minutes left. Let me get through these checkpoints here. God proposed that in this land, the law of God should be exalted and true worship preserved among its citizens. The task was particularly committed to who? The Seventh-day Adventists. What other church is teaching God's law? From the Bible, the biblical law, and the true Sabbath, the only Sabbath, and the Sabbath that is the seventh day, the fourth commandment that we keep because he kept it first. He rested in it from all the work that he had done. He blessed it and sanctified it. Genesis chapter 2, verses 1 and 2. The land was a strategic location where technology, travel, and industry would make it possible for missionaries to witness about the true creator God and his worship to the inhabitants of every nation, kindred, tongue, and people. However, if this nation would prove unworthy of God's trust, what would happen? National apostasy leads to national ruin. Last quote here, Signs of the Times, Ellen White says on July 4th, 1899, the greatest and most favored nation upon the earth is the United States. A gracious providence has shielded this country and poured upon her the choicest of heaven's blessings. Here the persecuted and oppressed have found refuge. Here the Christian faith in its purity has been taught. This people have been the recipients of great light and unrivaled mercies. However, these gifts have been repaid by ingratitude and forgetfulness of God. The Infinite One keeps a reckoning with the nations, and their guilt is proportioned to the light rejected. A fearful record now stands in the register of heaven against our land. But the crime which shall fill up the measure of iniquity is the making void the law of God. History repeats itself, doesn't it? Okay, let's put a mark, bottom of page 123. We'll pick up from another quote in Signs of the Times next week. And we'll have Doug close this Bible study session with prayer, please.
Yeah, let's bow our heads. Our dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for another day of life. And may we see life as with the importance that you give it. May we show in our lives the character that we find in you. As we look through these studies, we find the glory of the Lord is your character, your mercy, your love, your kindness, your compassion. This is all the glory of the Lord. And so we pray, Lord, that as we study, as we learn, and hopefully as we share, we can share the glory of the Lord. We love and thank you so much. And may we show people the significance of what the Bible has to say, not just what we think the Bible says. And I pray and ask for all of these things in your Son's holy name. Amen.
Amen. We're told to put on Christ. You know why we're told that? Because that shows whose side you're on. You go to a sports game, what do you see? Everybody's wearing a jersey of who they're supporting. Well, put on Christ. Wear that jersey. Hey, God bless you all. Happy Sabbath. Good to see you. We'll see you next week.